Well, now, as we come towards the end of this evening on BBC One, Michael Fish takes a late look at the weather.
Again, a good deal of cloud, a little rain from time to time for much of the day, but later on that rain is going to become ever more persistent, and eventually I think that rain will probably turn out to be fairly heavy.
What you've seen in any documentary about any band before or since is how great and wonderful everything is. It's not the truth of it. It's hell, it's hard, it's horrible. It's enjoyable to a small degree, but if you know what you're doing it for, you'll tolerate all that, because the work at the end of the day is what matters. We managed to offend all the people we were fucking fed up with. The Labour Party, who'd promised so much after the war, had done so little for the working class that the working class were confused about in themselves and didn't even understand what working class meant anymore.
Well, it's cold and miserable. No one had any jobs. You couldn't get a job. Everyone was on the dole. If you weren't born into money, then you might as well kiss your fucking life goodbye. You weren't going to amount to anything.
The germ, the seed, the Sex Pistols generated from that.
Now is the winter of our discontent, made glorious summer by this son of York.
England was in a state of social upheaval. It was a very, very different time. Total social chaos. There was rioting all over the place.
You want to join the picket line?
The strikes on every kind of amenity you could think of.
Power.
The TV channels would go on and off randomly. People were fed up with the old way. The old way was clearly not working.
A little bit sticking up there. You can see it in the reflection.
Ultra bright gets you noticed.
You're told at school, you're told at the job centre, you're told by everyone that you don't stand a chance. And you should just accept your lot and get on with it. That's where you're going to get social strife, hate and war and race hate. When you feel powerless, you will grab any power you can to retain some kind of self-respect.
Something on how many people have been mugged. Don't lay your hand on me, me son, so I'll break your fucking jaw.
That man is sad because he's misinformed and he's misled and he's used.
Yes, I am a racist, and why? Who's made me a racist? This government, the Conservatives, and every sturdy, stinking cancer who sticks up for the nigger. And I'll stand by my words. Because I don't like these people, never will do.
Words are my weapons. Violence is something I'm not very good at. I don't think you can explain how things happen, other than sometimes they just should. And the Sex Pistols should have happened and did.
I was born in Queen Charlotte's Hospital on September the 3rd, 1955. I live with my mother and my stepfather, who I thought was my dad, in the basement in Shepherd's Bush. and I slept at the edge of their bed, on a camp bed. My real daddy bailed when I was two. His name was Don Jarvis. He was an amateur boxer. I definitely didn't feel wanted as a child.
Well, I was born and raised around West London, the Shepherd's Bush and Hammersmith area. It was typically working class. I met Steve because we lived just around the corner from each other.
Went to school near Paul and Steve, next to Wormer Scrubs Prison. My dad was a factory worker. Mum works at a powder puff factory.
If you were to look back at me as a school kid, you'd see a very shy, quiet little church mouse kind of character in North London. Irish immigrant parents. My mum taught me to read and write after meningitis, a serious illness I had at seven when I was in a coma for a year. When I came out of hospital, I was completely brain wiped. All memories had been erased. I didn't remember anything at all. Just backwards in everything. It was like having to start all over again.
Pictures of Lily. How does it get from the man to the egg?
I actually got put back a year because I was so stupid. And I would never pay any attention in class. I was just always daydreaming.
Steve was quite wild at 10, 11 years old. I think he was always getting into trouble then.
You should make sure that you've got the thing around the right way.
On the other hand, I've got four fingers and a thumb.
I question everything. I always have done. We were doing Shakespeare. A teacher would give me a hard time when he wouldn't tell me what I wanted to know. I'd ask outright questions. And you're not supposed to do that. You're just supposed to accept it's Shakespeare, it's great, you're not. That's not good enough for me.
Well, I'd steal. I mean, that's all I knew how to do. I used to watch my parents steal at Tesco's when I was six. And I was always getting in trouble. And so that's all there was, music. Was totally into music, Roxy music and Bowie. I thought, look, musicians fell from the sky at that point. I didn't think anyone could be a musician.
I was very quiet at school up until about 14 or 15 when I decided I'd had enough. I knew we were being fobbed off and basically given a shoddy third-rate version of reality. So you would not be capable of questioning your future because you didn't have one. My mother loved Alice Cooper as much as I did. She had an extremely varied taste for everything from Irish folk music to T-Rex to some early Bowie, lots of the heavy metal that was around at the time, everything. Extremely Catholic taste. I want all you skinheads to get up on your feet.
Put the presses together and the food. Yeah. There's a lot of black kids at Shepherd's Bush. And we used to go to their parties and listen to ska music. It sort of developed from there, really, I think, our interest in music. I think it was Wally, the famous Wally Nightingale, who said, well, let's start a band. At the time, Wally said Steve would be the singer and I would be on drums. Wally actually played guitar, and so it was up to each of us to go off and learn our instruments.
We used to rehearse and rehearse and just kind of, like, fantasize, really. If I wanted to wear something that T-Rex was wearing a week before, I'd go down King's Road and fucking steal it. I always used to end up at Let It Rock, which was owned by Malcolm McLaren and Vivian Westwood. All the other shops you went in down at King's Road, you're walking in, you get like 10 puffs on you, asking you what you want, can I help you? So that's why we'd always end up at Vivian's, because it was like a hangout. I liked the clothes, they were different. It weren't all flares and kipper ties, you know, it was teddy boy clothes. It was a lot more rebellious, and obviously I was drawn to that.
The teddy boy thing for me was all about the idea of being a peacock and standing out in the crowd, but at the same time feeling a sense that you are part of the dispossessed, which at the end of my art school term, I thought I could make a profit by.
I became friends with Malcolm because he had a lot of contacts in music. He seemed to know everybody. He finds a way in with his blag, which is perfect for a manager.
I walked up and down the King's Road with complete anger and resentment. People were extremely absurd and still stuck into flares and platform shoes and neatly coiffured longish hair and pretending the world wasn't really happening. It was an escapism that I resented. There was also a garbage strike going on for years and years and years, and there was trash piled 10 foot high. They seem to have missed that. Wear the garbage bag, for God's sake, and then you're dealing with it. And that's what I would be doing. I would wrap myself basically in trash.
And that so lamely and unfashionable that dogs bark at me as I halt by them.
I've got news for you, dogs bark at me. In a weird way, that whole persona of, say, Richard III helped, when I joined the Sex Pistols, deformed, hilarious, grotesque, and the Hunchback of Notre Dame is in there, and just bizarre characters that somehow or other, through all of their deformities, managed to achieve something. Just for a short while, scratching
the sand, let go his hand. Steve was a kind of kleptomaniac, really. I'm sure he would be diagnosed as that, you know, because he couldn't keep his hands in his pockets, which was quite handy, really. We'd always know a way in round the back of Hammersmith Odeon, being our local area. David Bowie was playing the Ziggy farewell thing, and while the roadies was asleep in the front row, we'd be going around on stage, snipping all the microphones off. We had great guitars, amplifiers, great drum kits, PA system, everything. You know, we couldn't play it properly.
To prevent myself from being beaten up by what were Uxbridge teddy boys coming in, pilfering in the store, I decided to go down another route, rubber and leather fetish wear. I felt that that would look fun and exciting on the King's Road because it would have a similar effrontery that teddy boy clothes had, except it would be new.
Malcolm Shop interested me because the rubberware. Fascinating that people can get themselves into such a predicament that the only way they can have sex is in a face mask and a rubber t-shirt. With a bollock weight. How does it become that way? It becomes like that for you because you just cannot face reality.
Steve just came back one day and said, I found a bass player. I said, who's that? He said, this guy, Glenn, who works in Malcolm's shop.
Lo and behold, I started wrestling with him. I had so much equipment that Steve had assembled, shall we say.
We're always pestering Malcolm to manage us, and he said he'd be interested if we got rid of Wally.
He came down once and said, you shouldn't sing, you should play guitar and you should get a singer.
We realised Wally was going to have to go.
Alas, poor
Wally.
I knew him, Horatio.
Around this time, there was a group of guys who came from the north side of London who used to come into the shop probably for the same reasons we did, you know, on a Saturday or whatever. There was a group of them, apparently all called John.
Steve and Paul never believed we were all called John. They could never take that. Sid's real name is John. They just thought we were like a Clockwork Orange gang, you know, the Johns. I had no idea why they picked me out, other than they thought I looked well different from the pack.
We arranged to meet John one night in a pub just down the road.
We had a few pints, and then we came back to the shop.
We gave this singer an audition in my shop later on after the pub had closed, for him to imitate and for him to try to sing along with an Alice Cooper track on the jukebox called 18, which I adored. And he sung it like the Hunchback of Notre Dame.
I'm 18 and I don't know what I want.
I always did view myself as one damn ugly fucker. I certainly weren't no Belle of the Ball.
John just started going into spasms in front of the jukebox and singing and doing exact what later became everyone knows and loves, you know. And I knew right away then that he was the singer. He was going to be the one, really.
I personally wouldn't have got him in the band, even though he looked like a star. And I thought he was a wanker for taking a piss and he wasn't serious. But then after speaking to him for a while, I realised that that was his own insecurity to take the piss because he wasn't really a singer. John was from a different world to me and Cookie. He's more of an intellectual, John.
I knew what Steve was. I mean, I knew he had potential to be a great person. There's something in him that's genuine. I could see that there's a tragedy in him, just like in me. Deep down inside, they're wounded people. And then there's Glenn, waffling on about nice things like the Beatles. We're the very first people to call each other cunts, outright, face on, and know it. And we are. We all are, all our way. You put all this together and it makes for high drama. A bit like a Harold Pinter play. It shouldn't work, but it does.
If you could see, oh God, fuck
first rehearsals were a nightmare. I couldn't hold a damn note.
Paul couldn't really keep time. I couldn't play guitar. I fucking hated it. It was just a fucking noise. But I just stuck in there because that's all I had.
Oh, fuck, it's awful. Like that.
Right from the start, we'd argue. Bitterly. First day one rehearsal, pure, full-on row. It would be constantly, you know, you've got to learn to sing. And it's why? Says who? Who wrote the rules here? But that's all right. You need that difference of character.
I didn't think if I could be a sculptor, I necessarily needed clay. I suddenly thought, you can use people. And it's people that I used like an artist. I manipulated. So creating something called the Sex Pistols was my painting, my sculpture, my little artful dodgers.
You don't create me. I am me. There is a difference.
Everyone in the planet knows Malcolm's full of shit. He's convinced people now that he's full of shit by all the shit that he says. It gets worse and worse.
And the idea of the name Sex Pistols was sexy young assassins. Pistol meaning a gun, and then pistol meaning a kind of penis.
There was never a relationship with the manager for me, other than he would always try to steal my ideas and claim them to be his own. I had to accept that he was the manager because he was their manager before I joined the band.
I think they're the same fucking star sign, they're the same kind of personality. They were always butting heads. It was definitely John who steered the ship into the way we looked.
Torn safety pin, zips all over the gaff, third-rate tramp thing. That was poverty, really. Lack of money. The arse of your pants falls out. You just use safety pins.
And I always used to call him rotten, cos his fucking teeth are, like, dreadful. They look like dog ends. And it just stuck.
Steve always looked like a hairdresser on a high road. He had a perm, and unfortunately, it became permanent.
I don't have any heroes. They're all useless. There's no games around, is there? None. None are accessible.
It's Emerson, Lake and Palmer.
All those super bands at that time, Emerson, Lake and Palmer, yes, they were dinosaurs.
They were dreadful because they were fucking boring. Uriah Heep, fucking, you know, Gong.
I wanted the Sex Pistols to compete with the Bay City Rollers.
Can you imagine Johnny Rotten singing Shang-a-Lang? Shang-a-Lang. Shang-a-Lang.
Shang-a-Lang. Shang-a-Lang. Shang-a-Lang. Stradivarius was a terrible painter. And Redbud made rotten violins.
I got interested in the arts. I ended up going to St Martin's for a year. I walked in there and asked to see the social secretary, and this guy said, well, I am. And it was Sebastian Conran. They said, well, what's the name of your band? And I said, the Sex Pistols. And Sebastian went, the Sex Pistols? Oh, we must have them.
I remembered being just fucking terrified, and I had to take a Mandrax to calm down.
Hello.
I think I took two Mandrax. We went up there and it was all these arty-farty fuckers in this one room. There was no stage. And there was another band called Bazooka Joe. Adam Ant was the bass player in. And we were knocking the pints back. And it was time to go on. And the Mandrax were kicking in. And we started playing. I just remember looking at John and thinking, this is fucking fantastic. I love this. It was like one of the magical moments. Everything in the universe fucking clicked.
Glenn definitely wanted to be on Top of the Pops. I want you to know that I love you, baby. To me, that's really naff. So I want you to know I don't care. Comes quite naturally. If I take other people's songs, I put a twist on them.
Finally, we're actually playing in a band. I ain't the singer, I'm comfortable playing the guitar. Mind you, I was fucked up. And next thing I know, they pulled the plug on us and it was all over. I'm just like out of it and wandering around down Piccadilly Circus.
I die of nerves before I go on stage because I don't know what I'm going to do. And because of that, I'd have to just pull things out from deep down inside. Hello! 76 trombones to the hit parade. Look, there's Arthur Askey in there. There's Ken Dodd. We are the Diddy Men. We come from Nutty Ash. There's even... There's nothing wrong with me.
Do we know any other fucking songs we could do?
What Ian didn't understand about the Sex Pistols is that we are music hall.
Should we do Roadrunner? Hey, that's fucking awful. Stop it. Stop it. It's fucking awful.
There was always a sense of piss take and fun to it.
Shout out how it starts. What's the first line?
There's a sense of comedy in the English. Even in your grimmest moment.
All right, can you start at the beginning, Leon? I can't hear you, Paul.
You laugh.
You know, one week we'd be playing up in High Wycombe, opening up for Scream and Lord Such, and I remember seeing some faces in there, guys with long hair.
With all other indications, yes.
Radio 1.
but all other indications suggest.
And then, like, a week later, we'd be playing at the Nashville.
I fell in love with my mind.
Then we're in for a dirty night. A dirty night.
And I see the same people with the hair cut short and wearing the ripped up t-shirt. Every gig, you'd see a few more and a few more and a few more people who just got converted.
So the Sex Pistols definitely created new environments. It was incredible good to see the audience being individual. There were some absolutely stunning original people out there.
There's nothing wrong with me.
Sue Catwoman. That woman required a lot of skill, style, and bravery to look like a cat. There was a couple of years there where it was stunning. People that had no self-respect suddenly started to view themselves as beautiful in not being beautiful. Women started to appreciate themselves as not second-class citizens. Punk made that clear. I'd always talk to the audience in a one way after gigs. Where do you live? What's life like for you? Absolute basics.
He put her bicycle under a tree. I think that girl took a fancy to me.
But it was fun, I guess, talking to him. Well, actually, I didn't give a fuck about talking about the band. I just wanted to get me dick sucked, really. That was always the first thing on my mind. I wasn't interested in talking about politics after the show. Didn't even know who the fucking Prime Minister was at the time.
Let's have a ride on your bike.
I pretty much just wanted to have a bunk up, like any good teenager does.
Substitute I liked, but I only liked certain phrases in it, so I'd twist them about. Oh no, you can't do that. It's a classic, says Glenn. Fuck off!
I think when we started writing our own stuff is when it got more interesting. Because that's when it became our own musical force.
Glenn was coming up with most of the ideas of the songs, and John would just be sitting in the corner scribbling his lyrics out there and then while we were playing along to it.
We had something, we had a spirit, but what we didn't have a way of putting that into words, which is what John had.
The first line I wrote was, I am an antichrist. And I couldn't think of a damn thing that rhymed with it. And antichrist just fitted really nicely.
The only thing I didn't like about anarchy was the dreadful rhyme. Antichrist, antichrist, that used to always make me wince.
Oh,
today's
the fucking musical line!
I am an anarchist. Don't know what I want, but
happy. It was Attack. Attack, Attack, Attack.
He was the total Pistols fan, really.
I fucking loved that band, along with a couple of other kids that knew John. I think I was about the biggest fan they ever had.
How many ways to get what you want? I is the best, I is the rest.
Rotten was, like, incredible. Just, like, unbelievable. And Steve was fucking great as well. Glenn was a cunt, as always. What made the Sex Pistols different was John Rotten, because he was a total anti-star. He didn't, like, wiggle his bum or shake his hips. He did robot dances and just fucked around and took the piss out of everybody in a real nasty, snidey way.
Contingent, all the front row lot, they all ended up in bands, hence you got the punk movement.
To see us playing like just three chords gave the message that anybody could do this. Which was great, all these other bands started. I enjoyed watching the Clash, I enjoyed the band. It just happened so quick and it was so exciting. It's like, I think, wow, there's really a movement starting here.
One chick came down one night wearing a polka dot see-through Mac and nothing else. I actually saw one tourist stagger as she came into the club. I was so amazed by this appearance. Sid was amazing because he was a standout character in the crowd because he wasn't in the band then. He invented the pogo all by himself. First of all, he just sort of jumped up on the shoulders of some people to get a better look. But in the end, he just started jumping up and down anyway.
Yeah, I started it because I hated the Bromley contingent and I invented a dance that would involve being able to knock them all over the fucking 100 Club. So I just used to throw myself about, leap up like horizontal and sideways, just like boing, 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 like land on them and smash them into the floor.
Yeah, my name is Nick Kent. I'm a, once-renowned journalist for the New Musical Express, or Sid, as he was known then, who I'd encountered once before. I'd never actually met him. Was obviously under the influence of some sort of amphetamines or extreme adrenaline-propulsing stimulants. Sid Vicious was looking for a fight.
Just fucking watch out, pal, right? Otherwise I'll fucking slice you open.
He hit me over the head a few times with a chain, which didn't require any stitches, fortunately. I sort of wandered upstairs in a complete lather of blood and confusion. I truly admire their attitude. I thought it was very brave. Immediately before this attack occurred, John Rotten was deep in discussion with Sid. I figure that John was... Johnny, as he's known, was setting me up. This is all true. In fact, Sid got the name Vicious from that fight. John Rotten christened him Vicious from that fight, said he falling against the door.
Sid Vicious got the name after my pet hamster that bit him one day. And he was trying to be sweet to it. And its name was Sid. And he really liked that. Your Sid is vicious.
The group were doing a very private, I think secret show at the Screen on the Green in Islington. Well, I went along with a couple of our A&R people and Chris Wright, the chairman. Knocked on the door and somebody opened the door and said, fuck off. Well, we weren't going to be dissuaded, so we tapped on the door again and said, we're invited. And the head popped round again and said, fuck off.
They were a particularly ugly band. Oh, we're so pretty, oh, so pretty.
A little bit of a scuffle, nothing much. Allowing musicians to defend themselves if the thing goes on through stage. I've never seen musicians drop their instruments and sort of dive in a small scrap and extend it and forget about the music, and I found that a bit much.
Went back two or three times after that just to make sure that, you know, they were as bad as I thought they were the first time. And we don't
care. Why all the infamous language?
Infamous language? You're joking. I speak nothing but the fucking English language. And if that's infamous, then
tough titters.
Basically, the Pistols' attitude to the press was one of completely, like, fuck you, you know? I mean, just absolutely fuck you, which was great. I mean, it was a perfect antidote to all the 99% of other stupid rock groups who, like, licked the arse of the press. And, I mean, it worked perfectly for them. Most journalists are masochists. They just toss pots most of them.
Don't accept the old order. Get rid of it.
We've been there for 5 years or more just waiting for this to happen, and now it's happened.
It had to. It was the only thing that could happen. It was the only thing that didn't come from the industry. It came from the kids themselves. Something had to come from the kids.
The leaders of a whole new teenage cult that seems to be on the way to being as big as mods and rockers were in the 60s.
The cult is called punk. The music, punk rock, basic rock music, raw, outrageous and crude, like their fan magazine, Sniffing Glue.
I think our music is very honest. It's the most honest thing that's been happening in the last 15 years. Nothing to beat it.
Finding places to play is becoming harder, thanks to the reputation punks are getting as troublemakers. And the Sex Pistols themselves even had to hire a strip club to get their music heard. Nowhere else would take them.
The Pistols very believable. I find it's all related to violence in the mind, not in the body.
Malcolm began to get a little bit serious about it, and he brought in a lawyer by the name of Fisher.
That dreadful lawyer whose name I refuse to speak.
There was basically an auction between Polydor and EMI.
We came up with a contract which gave the Pistols total creative control.
Malcolm decided to go with EMI.
to the A&R department and said, who are these crazy guys, man? I mean, who are they? This is the Sex Pistols, which I signed them. They're tremendous. And my first actual plug for them was after all this, was by phoning up the Today programme. They phoned me and said, yes, we'd like to use the Sex Pistols, you know, will they be OK? I said, well, sure, I'm sure they'll be all right.
They slung us in a green room with a fridge, and I remember downing about fucking four bottles of Blue Nun, and I was fucking just having a good old time pissed at this point by the time when we went out there. And that's all I remember.
They are punk rockers. The new craze, they tell me. They're heroes, not the nice, clean Rolling Stones. You see, they're as drunk as I am. They are clean by comparison. They're a group called the Sex Pistols. I am told that that group have received £40,000 from a record company. Doesn't that seem to be slightly opposed to their anti-materialistic view of life?
More the merrier.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Well, tell me more about it.
We've fucking spent it, haven't we?
I don't know, have you?
Yeah. Yeah, it's all gone.
No one even heard that one, because he was drunk himself. And he wasn't paying attention when he asked, well, what did you do the money? And I said, we fucking spent it.
Well, tell me more about it.
We fucking spent it, haven't we?
I don't know, have you?
Yeah, yeah. It's all gone.
Really?
Down at
Boulder. Really? Good Lord. Now, I want to know one thing. Beethoven, Mozart, Bach and Brahms have all died. Really? What are we saying, sir?
Wonderful people.
Are they?
Oh, yes, they really turn us on.
What do they do?
Well, suppose they turn other people on.
And rotten, he slipped up and said shit under his breath.
Which one?
Nothing, a rude word. Next question.
No, what was the rude word?
Shit.
What is it really? Good heavens, you frightened me to death.
Oh, all right.
What about you girls behind? Are you,
your granddad.
Are you worried or are you just enjoying yourself?
Enjoying myself.
Are you?
Yeah.
That's what I thought you were doing.
I always wanted to meet you.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Susie, she was just being like coy with him. And he said, oh, maybe we'll meet after.
We'll meet after, shall we?
You dirty son. You dirty old man.
Steve completely understood that he was talking to a drunk, as you would a drunk in a pub, and he just topped him.
Well, keep going, Chief, keep going. Go on, you've got another 5 seconds. Say something outrageous.
You dirty bastard. I just remember this fucking cunt just started provoking us and we coated him off.
Go on, again.
You dirty fucker.
What a clever boy.
What a fucking rotter.
Well, that's it for tonight. The other rocker, Abel, and I'm saying nothing else about him, will be back tomorrow. I'll be seeing you soon. I hope I'm not seeing you again. From me, though, good night.
McLaren was there. He was terrified. He was shitting himself.
With death white, you know, going, we fucking better get out of here, quick.
But the very next day, it was all his big idea, you know.
It was perfect stand-up comedy. It was Arthur-esque.
A four-letter word done everything.
I loved it. I fucking loved it. It was like finally I've arrived and the circus had begun.
The committee have decided that in fairness to the public of Derby, Sex Pistols will not perform here tonight, but we are quite agreeable that the three of the groups that have already been booked will go on.
For the last 12 months, punk rock has become almost a battle cry in British society. For many people, it's a bigger threat to our way of life than Russian communism or hyperinflation, and it certainly generates more popular excitement than either of those.
We hope tonight by this protest to make Wales know, to let the people of this town know that we do protest and it is by no fault of ours that this thing has come to Caerphilly.
When your local council didn't ban a punk rock concert, you actually went down there and tried to stop it yourself.
No, we never went to stop it at any time. We went there with a very positive gospel message.
We have done everything humanly possible to ban this thing and to stop it.
Excuse me, sir, can I ask you why you're here tonight?
Because I'm recognised as a Christian.
If I thought one of mine was in there, I'd go and then drag them out.
The thing is, they're outside, freezing. We're really all right.
Tour was actually followed everywhere across the country from gig to gig, and we had to turn up to show willingness to play, so presumably we would get the money, although it looked pounds to a penny that they wasn't going to let us play.
Mr. Stabler, you can't watch punk concerts in Newcastle either.
The decision was made when we discovered it was mere children that would be watching the performance. The average adult can go see a strip show or a blue film.
Banned in this town and being banned in that town, and it really wasn't about us playing anymore. It was about this controversy that we were like throwing up on stage and spitting.
And I remember going across the panel and being followed by a fleet of press people. We went to stop to get a coffee and a sandwich, and we could hear what these press people were saying. And one press guy said to the other, "Did he get anything?" And the other one said, "I got two fucks and a shit from Johnny Rotten. Great."
Can I now turn to Bernard Brooke Partridge in London?
I think most of these groups would be vastly improved by sudden death. The worst currently are the Sex Pistols. They are the antithesis of humankind. And the whole world would be vastly improved by their total and utter non-existence.
The day Johnny Rotten goes back on the words he writes in his songs is the day he dies, and I know that for a fact.
I think people did feel that this was a sort of a downhill thing and was a monster in our presence, and actually would cause problems of image for the record industry.
At that point, someone at TMI took the decision that they no longer wished to have the act on the label.
This is about EMI!
They're major labels with major attitudes, and they want everything to be fake and easily manipulative. You can't be having that with people like us.
Like chaos!
It just doesn't happen.
It's an unlimited supply, and there is no reason why.
Tell us that they were unable to continue to promote the act, and would we kindly leave?
Who?
Started with John and Glenn falling out, really, over what I don't really know, just a clash of personalities, etc.
When you talk like an arsehole and look like an arsehole, you're an arsehole.
There was obviously a big problem between me and John. I felt that once John got his face in the papers, he'd become a different person, which I didn't particularly like. When we went to Holland, my last gig with him was at the Paradiso, I felt everybody was on my case.
He was always complaining that we were too outrageous, and it's a funny thing, but he was always washing himself. Whenever we'd get into a hotel, he'd be washing his fucking feet in the sink.
Me and Steve were like that, I suppose, and John always felt on the outside. He thought by bringing Sid in, he would have someone there, like a partner, you know? Someone a bit closer to him.
I'd heard that they'd been rehearsing Sid, and nobody had the courtesy to tell me.
I
become like a cartoon strip band, as opposed to a rock and roll band that actually plays and does something for real.
I've got no emotion for anybody else. I better understand I'm in love with myself.
Glenn had reached a point where he decided that the band's direction was absolutely alien to anything he wanted to be associated with.
That's absolute bollocks. I think one of Malcolm's games was sort of divide and conquer. Malcolm had told John I'd said a lot of stuff which I hadn't said, and Malcolm had told me John had said a lot of stuff that he hadn't said.
I respect him. I always did. He taught them to play.
I kind of regretted him leaving because Sid couldn't play a fucking note.
I feel guilty about Sid because I wish I could have told him more about what to expect.
Well, I was getting my own group together, the Flowers of Romance, and Rotten asked me if I wanted to join the... There's this big hoo-ha, and Malcolm said, it's all a big secret, man, you know. Come down to this pub at such and such now. I thought they were going to do me over because I didn't turn up to one of Rotten's parties or something. He gets touchy over things like that. And I went down there and he said, do you want to play bass for the Sex Pistols?
Close mate. You just laugh at everything. Genius in that way. And his name was John. We do lots of mad things together, me and Sid. We used to busk too for money. Me with a violin, Sid with a tambourine, maybe a broken guitar, doing Alice Cooper songs. I Love the Dead was our favourite. That would get us the most money. Just please shut up. Here, take the money, go somewhere else.
Why dost thou spit at me?
The best time of the band of all was when Sid first joined, and he was really determined to learn the bass and fit in and be part of the band.
He definitely looked great, Sid. You know, he definitely was a face. But we had a laugh. We should take the piss out of Rotten.
All I did was cash in on the fact that I'm good looking and I have a good figure and girls like me. Well, they want a fucking angel in flares and an anorak. Because if they want that, that ain't me, baby.
I found myself in this rather curious little shop in the company of Johnny Rotten, Sid Vicious and other assorted Sex Pistols.
Hello, Mr. Nimmo.
And the last they heard, a donkey had him cornered up a back alley in Fulham.
After EMI dumped the Sex Pistols, A&M Records picked them up and staged a contract signing ceremony in front of Buckingham Palace.
Malcolm was honest in one respect, that he always said he had no control over us, and he didn't. And a bloody good punch-up in a limo before a signing was not really unusual. It was a good fight, too. No, you're the biggest cunt. No, you're the worst cunt. No, you're the cunt, etc., etc. There was only one cunt I wanted to smack, and that was Malcolm. Then the door opened, and then we had to do the signing.
At this point, the Sex Pistols, despite having been fired, were not exactly suffering. Here they were signing a new contract that could make them a lot of money, and they already had a song to record for A&M in honor of the Queen's Jubilee.
Sid's father was a Grenadier Guard, Imagine that. Sid's signing a very expensive contract while his old man's on guard inside the fence. It's genius.
According to the story, after this happy signing ceremony, everyone went back to the A&M offices to celebrate. The four Sex Pistols apparently over-celebrated and lived up to their public image of thorough obnoxiousness.
How you doing?
Yeah.
We got to A&M Records. Total bedlam broke out there as well. I can't really remember what happened. The secretaries were terrified and Sid was bleeding, all his foot was bleeding. I had a black eye. Malcolm was running around, Steve was flirting with all the secretaries, and then we got in the car again, went to the studio and where we were recording God Save the Queen with Chris Thomas, and there's a school next door, and all the kids come running out because we were there, and they called the police as well. It was just a total mad day, you know. The next day we woke up, Malcolm said, well, A&M have fired you.
The anti-establishment Sex Pistols called in the establishment press to protest what had happened to them.
You feel that we're like some contagious disease. I mean, when you walk in and out of a company and a guy just gives you, look, you know, take this money and don't come back, what are you supposed to think about that?
Have you had the money?
Yes, they gave us the check last night.
Makes it very clear where their heads are at. Nowhere.
We weren't the nice boys they thought we were. We aren't nice boys. We were fucking nasty little bastards. And we still are.
Virgin Records signed them, and Johnny Rotten got to record his Queen's Jubilee memorial song, God Save the Queen.
You don't write God Save the Queen because you hate the English race. You write a song like that because you love them, and you're fed up with them being mistreated.
I think what he was singing about was outrageous. He's not saying let's kill her or let's fuck her. He was pretty much pointing out what the truth was.
Chris Hedman.
Alienated the entire country. If they'd have hung us at Traitor's Gate, it would have been applauded by 56 million.
You can't beat that, man. That's National Gallery status.
It's raining silver in the sun this week.
God Save the Queen was the alternative national anthem. What we offered to England was a pivotal point. We were the maypole that they danced around.
Go away, hate you, hate you, hate you. Go away, hate you, far across the sea.
We're about to celebrate the release of God Save the Queen and down the Thames and start playing outside the Houses of Parliament, God Save the Queen, and Anarchy in the UK on the Jubilee Day.
I just wanted out of the country, and there was no way out.
Ever get the feeling you've been trapped? This is insane, the whole thing. All of this is bullshit, isn't it? Well, I've had enough of you bullshit.
I'm too cold, so I'm going back downstairs.
I loved it. Getting my 20 quid a week, thinking everything was great.
I didn't want to fucking deal with the business side of it. I didn't really question it. I was McLaren's friend before the band, so I trusted McLaren like a friend.
Emerson, Lake, and Palmer and Fanfare for the Common Man. At 5, Electric Light Orchestra, Bullmire. 4, Stranglers and Peaches. 3, Boom, Love a Boy. And 2, Eagles, Hotel California. Sex Pistols' current record, God Save the Queen, is at number 1 in the Capitol hit line today. But the IBA, which administers the Broadcasting Act, has advised us that particularly at this time, this record is likely to cause offense to a number of our listeners, and have asked us not to play it in our normal programming.
God Save the Queen was never number one. There was no number one that week. Whatever we were saying and doing really hit a nerve, a raw nerve. It was fucked up. I still had to bunk on the subways, couldn't afford a cab, and all of that the management didn't want to deal with. Completely from there on in, walking around the streets of London on my own was impossible. I would be attacked on sight. You felt like a werewolf being hounded. Constantly in fear of your life, really.
God save the Queen, eh, John?
I got a machete blade ripped down this leg, and the blade stuck in my kneecap, and they couldn't pull it out, so I had to walk off with that. I got a stiletto blade from my wrist here. Lucky not to have had one of my eyes gouged out, because a bottle was shoved in here. Got to the hospital, first thing they do is call the police. I get arrested for suspicion of causing an affray.
And the telephone call from the editor, who would say, Malcolm, we'll print anything, because you sell more papers than we ever did on Armistice Day.
It's 7 o'clock on Wednesday, the 17th of August. Elvis Presley, at one time known to millions as the King of Rock and Roll, has died suddenly at the age of 42.
The King of Rock and Roll died yesterday. He was found face down on a bathroom floor. There have been numerous reports that Presley was a heavy drug user.
All that time when Malcolm was saying, we can't get gigs in the UK, we could have played abroad, we could have fucking done nothing, couldn't we, Julian? Who needs a fucking UK? It's a load of fucking shit. Got a lot of wax in my ears today. So we were left doing nothing. I was just sitting there. We didn't even fucking rehearse. Nobody wanted to fucking rehearse or do anything. So, it's a logical conclusion, do you know what I mean? Boredom. And, I'm that way inclined, so what do I turn to?
No, I couldn't take them off. My nose is broken. I'm keeping them on.
And she showed up with Sid, and I was thinking, who the fuck is this cunt? This is an horrible person. It was like the weirdest thing. I never felt such a negative energy from someone. It was just a dark cloud with this bird. And I fucking hated her.
First time I came across Nancy, I think Steve was shagging her in the toilet. I didn't like her.
Nancy was a hooker that was on the coattails of the New York Dolls. And I actually introduced her to Sid. Shame on me.
In New York, I was dancing without any clothes on. You used to go down to the guys and dance in front of them and then get tips off them. And you do a little hand job, you know, for $10. They wanted to fuck. I just, you know. Did it, you know, there wasn't really anything to it. I just give good blowjobs.
That'll rip your balls off.
I read the first Sex Pistols review. It was shit, and I said, I gotta get over that. I wanted to see something exciting.
Nancy, as his heroin dealer stroke girlfriend, was pumping him up with gear every chance she could get.
He didn't lie to me because I was a junkie. He tried to keep me and Sid apart for months. Months, months.
Everyone knows when a bird starts poking their nose into a rock and roll band, it's suicidal. Because that's when he really started getting fucked up and not caring about playing. I didn't want anything to do with her.
We did everything to get rid of Nancy that was physically possible. I even dangled her out of a window one night by her ankles.
The rest of the band hated me. Because I was just the New York Dolls. Johnny and Jerry, and they were junkies.
They definitely brought a lot of heroin around too. And I know Sid was totally into Johnny Funders.
I like New York Dolls. Because they were nasty and mean, and they wore makeup, and they didn't give a shit. And they played god-awful rock and roll, and they had good names and good hairdos.
It definitely had a big effect on me. I thought he was the coolest thing ever, Funders at that time. Started stealing some of his stances and his looks and, you know, his moves on stage. And I look back at it now, I'm embarrassed on how much I fucking was trying to copy him. I didn't need to do that. I had my own thing already. My invention to the Sex Pistols was the hanging on the head. Kind of funny, actually, when I used to see fans doing it. I thought, oh, look, they're doing something I invented.
Cunt, shit, bollocks, Phil Grundy's a pop.
It kind of made my self-esteem rise an inch.
Leather jackets came with the heroin.
Vampirish goth look
came with the heroin. This ruined Sid.
Hey, want one of these?
He was a complete gullible fashion victim. Sid went straight into the worst kind of rock and roll idiot you could ever hope to have a nightmare about. And didn't get that what we were doing was...
We want some safety.
Our culture, our lives.
Who else wants something? Come on if you want something, you cunts.
All I can tell you is, yes, I can take on England, but I couldn't take on one heroin addict.
Oh, no, Sid.
A time where we should have been the tightest, it couldn't be looser. They adopted a uniform image and attitude, and the whole thing was about being yourself.
The cliched punk look, which became a postcard punk, where you were a Mohican and all black with spiky hair and all that, it was never like that. To start with, they didn't have the money to go out and buy a 50 quid leather jacket. It was very much a do-it-yourself kind of thing, you know.
And all those garbage, trashy bands, basically all saying, yeah, we're a punk band, wrecked it outright. It became acceptable, absorbed back into the system, the shitstem.
Killed Bambi, it was Malcolm's idea. We were musicians, we didn't want to make a film. Malcolm was very good at spending other people's money. There was a load being put into the film from the band's royalties, which we didn't know about. I remember just turning up to do a scene. There was this guy there, I thought, well, he looks familiar.
Do you know the way to Hindley Airfield, mate?
And I said, I know you from somewhere. And it was Steen. It was his motion picture debut, I believe.
So it's flying lessons you're after, is it? Well, you've come to the right place, Sex Pistol.
Be advised, drummer boy. We're the sensational new Blow Waves. And we know how to sell more records than Malcolm McLaren.
And I knew that it was just trash, rubbishing the whole point and purpose.
We believe in rock and roll, and we don't need you, Sex Pistol. The record companies know that our music means more to them than your sick anarchy ever did.
Get out of my car, you cunt.
He used to really get the hump McLaren when we started asking for money, so I stopped asking for it. We never had our own lawyer, which is insanity. That's the closest thing to being in one of these boy bands, is that they all get reamed. And we were getting reamed in that department.
How can you be a Sex Pistol with no money? You ring the office, you get zero response. Your checks weren't paid. No rent, no earnings. A complete disaster.
It was wonderful. God save the Queen!
It was a monkey's tea party. What the fuck was the manager doing? The one that claimed that he was manipulating everything. He manipulated nothing. He was clueless at that point.
Once we said, we're fucking leaving the group unless you fucking get some gigs, you stupid little cunt. You got something together the next day. Well, he could have done that all the time.
Spots was a good one, Sex Pistols on tour. But I thought it was dreadful that we had to, like, not be ourselves and go under secret monikers. I'm a Sex Pistol, and that's it.
And we just did these secret gigs in the small clubs, and it was just packed. Fans who'd never seen us. And they were, like, the best shows, man. They were fucking great.
Days and the sun was our crowning glory.
It's this surround sound in a 2-inch wall. I was waiting for the communist call. I didn't ask for sunshine and I got what was free. I'm looking over the wall and they don't connect me. Now I got a reason, now I got a reason, now I got a reason and I'm still waiting.
Huddersfield, I remember very fondly. Two concerts, a matinee with children throwing pies at me, and later on that night, striking union members. It was heaven.
We've got one lady who wants Dad back at work, which I think is a very good idea indeed.
It was like our Christmas party, really. I remember everyone being really relaxed that day. Everyone was getting on really well. Everyone was in such a great mood. It was a benefit for the kids of firemen who were on strike around that time and who had been on strike for a long time.
Because I have been to Santa Claus today and I have got you a schedule. A
lot of love in the house. Hey, and Sid was great that day. Everything about it was just wonderful.
OK, gang, this party is given to you absolutely free and at the expense of the Sex Pistols, so let's have a big cheer for the Sex Pistols. Come on, let's hear it.
Hey!
creation of an MI5 blacklist, there are certain groups whom we do not regard with favour and whom I personally will do everything I can within the law to prevent ever coming to London again.
Gig in England.
Yeah, who's this?
Thanks, Crystal.
Big Vicious?
Yeah.
This is Rodney Bingenheimer, Rodney on the Rock Show.
Oh, hi, man. No future.
Is Johnny Rotten there?
Yeah.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm doing all right.
You'll be coming to America soon, won't you?
Get hip, move to California.
Come to California.
It's the best.
No, I don't know. Can you get egg and chips?
You can do anything you want here, man. No one is repressed in L.A.
Oh, yes, you are. Mentally repressed, yeah.
Right. That's true.
This week on Don Kirshner's Rock Concert, The Incredible Kansas. Family Funk from the Silvers. The outrageousness of the Sex Pistols. Some slick dealing from Ricky J. And funny man Robert Aguayo.
We had trouble getting our visas because we had criminal records, all of us.
They strip searched us at the airport, and thank God Sid was the first one they strip searched, because as soon as they'd seen his underwear, that was it, we were safe. They had no wish to play with the rest of our willies after that point.
Across the globe, they achieved a notoriety in 19 languages. In the city, voted Young Businessmen of the Year by the Investors Review. On Fleet Street, they sold more papers than the Armistice. They didn't care about the music. They were purely into chaos.
Security was tight for the arrival of the infamous punk rock group known as the Sex Pistols, that naughty bunch of counterculture radicals. Warner Records had warned that the group might attack members of the American press. But when Steve Jones, Paul Cook, Johnny Rotten, and Sid Vicious arrived, this is what they had to say. Nothing.
Well, coming to America was definitely a strange experience. We had like these bodyguards, walkie-talkies and that, continually followed by like FBI and fucking CIA and 50 journalists. And it was kind of scary.
And here they are, at least two of them in a hotel room in Atlanta, waiting for the other two to do a promised interview. But they're in a strange mood, flaky, demanding they be paid $10 before they'll do any bleep-bleep interview. Denied that, they stomp off. Bleep, they say. When the four young men left, their spit was on the carpet, their butts on the floor, the dregs of an afternoon's beer and booze, and a couple of empty boxes of Clarissa. They left the hotel to go to a sex devices store, and then to their first concert in America.
We didn't come from America. We didn't understand America. So how the fuck could they understand us?
Okay, are you cowboys?
Oh, yeah.
You faggots!
And I said, you fucking motherfucking faggot cowboys. And they were throwing a rain of bottles and beer cans and pigs' noses and fuck knows what.
How
I got a full can of beer, smashed one of my lips. Fucking big fat lip, blood dripping down it.
The gigs were pretty frightening because of all the publicity that preceded us. People had come there just to see this freak show. They thought we were going to be sick on stage, crap on stage, beat each other up, kill each other. That was partly true. And Sid started beating himself, cutting himself on stage and totally being out to lunch.
Birds were better looking in America, that's for sure. I really enjoyed that part of it. They knew how to suck dick. They learn at an early age, you know.
Sid loved the Pistols as a fan. Being on stage with us, he couldn't cope. He wasn't being himself anymore. He was trying to be Johnny Rotten with the drugs. And that showed, I think, to my mind, very bad.
The fucking Texas patrolman took me and threw me out the door. And they have the authority because they have a badge and they have a fucking billy club and a gun.
He liked the idea of Sid being outrageous, and however much it fucked things up for the band, I think he encouraged him. I remember Sid saying once, you can never be outrageous enough, and Matt was saying, yes, yes, I agree, yes, you can go mad, get all the way.
It says to me that I should do what I want to do, you know, and just fuck everybody else, you know, just fuck them.
They made me shake more than I've ever shook before, and that's what makes them the best.
I think I heard one time that they urinate on the audience one time. Why, I don't know. It just sounds goofy.
Get out of here.
What do they sing? Let's sing.
Get out of here.
Better than homework.
Well, get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, the guy fucking tried to climb up on stage and fucking attack me. So I smashed his fucking brains in with my guitar.
He knew that I meant physical harm, and I have to say I was ugly about it. But he came out and hit us over the head with a bass.
They were great. If I could only make out the words, they'd be greater.
As my first time in America, Sid would sit next to me and we'd look out the window and we'd stare at that endless scenery and imagine John Wayne and the Indians. You wouldn't sleep, you wouldn't want to, because it was so first time. Stephen Paul flew around America with Malcolm.
Stephen, what kind of badge you got?
Safety department.
That's very good. Say goodbye.
They didn't want to be on the tour bus because they were really bored with that reggae man.
Stephen Paul are a pair of sheep. They do what Malcolm says.
Sid was just looking for a smack and being an idiot. Rotten got into his ego. It just got really depressing really quick.
But the point is, Sid's my mate, and I don't want him to be a junkie. This is why we travelled on the bus, this is why Sid was to stick with me.
And, like, the others just didn't understand. They thought, you know, oh, you can handle it, man. But, like, dope sickness isn't like that. It's not something that you can just blow away. It's the worst sickness you could ever imagine.
He was far too young for that shit. And un-American for that shit. I can drink, and I can drink a druggie out of being a druggie. And I will do that for my friends every time, any time.
You can't get comfortable, and you sweat, and you're boiling hot, and you pour with sweat, and your nose dribbles, and all of a sudden you get the colds, and the sweat turns to fucking ice on you. And you put a jumper on, and then you're boiling hot again, you take it off, and like, you get cold again, and like, you just can't win. You lie down, and that's not comfortable. You sit up, that's not comfortable. It drives you insane.
I despise Sid for it, and I'll despise anyone for messing with it ever since. It is the only drug that really cancels out all creativity. It is about self-pity. It is the lowest, worst form of life.
Well, he wasn't even playing at the end. You know, he could barely play anyway. Half the time he wasn't even plugged in. You know, it was like a joke. He's like, what the fuck am I up here for? What am I doing with this fucking, like, kind of circus? I just didn't want any part of it.
In the end, like, I was the only one who had any anarchy left in me. The rest of the band, they couldn't fucking take it.
And then we got to, like I said, San Francisco, and Malcolm's in town, and Sid goes off with Malcolm. Suddenly, Sid comes back smacked up.
Winterland, the final countdown.
It wasn't a rock and roll party. It was more like a dying horse that needed putting out of its misery.
Malcolm saw it more as a media circus. He didn't realise what a great band we were.
This is KSAN in San Francisco. The Sex Pistols, live from Winterland. Throughout the show, people were hurling things at them from all over, from above, from the sides, from right down below, and there were people jumping up on stage and being carried off. Stage is, here they come.
It's not really impossible in San Francisco to have monitors that work. Is it? Is it impossible to have a sound check? No.
Here's the encore for the Sex Pistols.
Malcolm was set it up to look ridiculous. We were all cheated, audience and lead singer alike.
You'll get one number and one number only, because I'm a lazy bastard.
You have to understand, they stayed in a very nice hotel.
This is no fun.
Me and Sid were not allowed in that very nice hotel. We had to stay with the road crew in a motel. The sheer lack of respect when we rang for Malcolm and him not returning a call. That was it for me.
It wasn't connived at all. We got to our hotel and booked in there. I wasn't aware that he didn't get a room there, you know, so he ended up staying somewhere else.
Malcolm was fucking with me. I had no credit card, no money, no ticket. He was trying to wreck the very thing that made the Sex Pistols great, and he managed to achieve it that night.
Came over, we tried to have a clear the air talk. We said to him, I don't want to carry on really much longer. The way this is going, it's like it's totally pointless. Someone's going to get killed, you know. John said he thought the problem was Malcolm and we should get rid of Malcolm and carry on and try and work it out that way.
Fun to be alone, walking by myself. Fun to be alone, in love.
I didn't really hang out with John. He was always draining to me. Took up a lot of energy. Malcolm I got along with, so I kind of went on McLaren's side. Another thing I regret.
I'd have dropped Sid in a second at that particular point for the band, because I knew he was fucking up.
That was just a load of cobblers. I was just playing bass and going crazy and leaping up and down. He thought I was trying to take over his position as the new Johnny Rotten.
Now fun! Now fun!
I don't want to be a junkie for the rest of my life. I don't want to be a junkie at all.
Now fun!
I knew the second Sid would smack himself off again. That was the end.
I was the one who said, I've had enough. I just couldn't handle it anymore. I didn't want nothing to do with rotten and vicious.
Oh, bollocks, why should I carry on?
I regret saying that, that I wanted out and leaving. I regret it, I really do. You know, I apologise to John that I fucking bailed.
Now, fine, now.
We might have continued if we'd have got rid of Malcolm. That's just the way I felt, man, and I couldn't get away from my feelings at the time.
I knew it had to end. I didn't think it would end with them being total wanker cowards. Stephen Paul fannied out on me.
The last show was the worst show I think we've ever played. It's just like, this ain't going nowhere. This ain't going anywhere. It's fucking over. Cookie agreed, and we just fucked off.
The night the group split up, Vicious was pulled off a plane at Kennedy Airport, the victim of a drug overdose.
Despite all the hassles, what was it that you thought the pistol we were trying to do? Was it just like re-kick the establishment out of the arse? Sid?
Sid's got an interview with me. Please try and wake up.
Ow!
Sid, damn you! Fuck! Everybody was for Sid. I mean, Sid was like, I don't know if he saw any of the gigs, but Sid was like really shining out. And John was being like, nothing.
Sid. I feel nothing but grief, sorrow, and sadness for Sid. To the point, like, if I really, like, talk about it, I'd just fucking burst out in tears. He's someone I really cared for, you see. He's one of the Johns. I care about every single one of the Johns. The Gang of Johns should have been the band.
Wake up.
Yeah, OK, I'll wake up. Right, now, what's the next question?
I can't be more honest than that.
Don't drop it on me again.
There was blood on the sheets and blood on the mattress. There was tracks of blood leading into the bathroom where the body of the female was found lying under the sink, and she was stabbed in the stomach.
The whole thing lasted no more than 3 minutes, and out they went. Vicious made no attempt to duck the cameras waiting outside the courtroom, but he refused to respond to any of the reporters' questions and shoved persistent microphones out of his path. The grand jury will decide whether or not to indict Vicious for murder. If he is indicted, the case moves to the Supreme Court for further action. Vicious was ordered to Rikers Island. If convicted of the stabbing death of Miss Fungin, Vicious faces 15 years to life in prison.
Now,
are you having fun at the moment?
Are you kidding? No, I'm not having fun at all.
Where would you like to be?
Under the ground.
Are you serious?
Oh, yeah.
I've lost my friend. I couldn't have changed it. I was too young. God, I wish I was smarter. You can look back on it and go, I could have done something. He died, for fuck's sake. They just turned it into making money. Ha, 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 ha. Hilarious for them. Fucking cheek. I'll hate them forever for doing that. You can't get more evil than that, can you, Julian, really? You know? No respect. Vicious. Poor sod.
You fucking motherfucking faggot cowboys. You can throw any fucking thing in the world at us and we won't get us off this stage.
We gave it fucking 200% for like 2 years and then that was it. I think we run out of steam.
You dirty fucker.
I love being a sex pistol. I'll always be a sex pistol. But at least, you know, when I die, at least I can say I've done something.
No fun.
Press the self-destruct button and start again, which is what it was all about, really.
No fun.
So creating something called the Sex Pistols was my painting, my sculpture, my little artful dodgers.
Are you still waffling, Malcolm? The Sex Pistols ended at exactly the right time for all the wrong reasons, but the wrong reasons were continued and people continued to perpetrate lies about a reality.
Ever get the feeling you've been cheated? Good night.
We did what we had to do, and that's why we didn't survive. Only the fakes survive. All I want is for future generations to just go, fuck it, had enough. Here's the truth.